Thank you very much, Tao. What I want to talk about this morning is to give an introduction, as Tao said, to the geodemographics stream to the CPC grant, which is embedded in another EPSRC grant, which is joint with colleagues at Birmingham and City University, which is called the Uncertainty of Identity. And in effect, what I want to do is sort of suggest to you in this brief overview, brief and partial overview of some aspects of the work programme, that a name is a statement. A name is a statement of identity that that links people and places. And in terms of the background, the geographic background to this work, it really lies in a field termed geodemographics, which is the analysis of people by where they live, which in effect presents us with measures of the social similarities that link spaces in different parts of a national system or even an international system. And so I want to give some flavour today of the ways in which family names are integral indicators of place profiles. Let's just see if this works. No?
It's
on track. Sorry? All right, okay, never mind. Okay. So this, the tradition of geodemographics has quite deep roots in urban sociology and geography, and it presents a way of specifying and generalizing about social similarity. And we'll come back to the point of generalization and representation perhaps in a minute. They're indicators of small area neighborhood conditions which have been extended from the private sector domain, people's consumption of private goods and services, profiling who's likely to take a holiday that's long haul versus short haul, for example, towards aspects of collective consumption, which is why the Metropolitan Police, for example, already use commercial geodemographics, because they provide indicators of attitudes to collective consumption, attitudes, for example, to support for the police. Nevertheless, many commercial systems are closed, so-called black boxes, where the specification, estimation, and testing of these small area indicators are commercial secrets. And Mohammed Adnan, who will give one of the five-minute presentations towards the end of this section, has done a lot of work on opening up the different methodologies which are used to devise the most efficient and effective indicators of small area conditions. And progress has also been made in the spatial and temporal transferability of your geodemographics. Oh, that's kind. Right, brilliant. I think we're. No.
No. It won't work.
No, it won't work. Okay. So, and this is where I'll switch the lights on again in a minute. You know, sort of squeal if something terrible happens to you. But this is really the state of the art of geodemographics circa 1951. Chev Kimball's classic study, social area analysis of the San Francisco Bay region, where small area measures are used to discriminate between between neighborhoods. And here, if you like, in some ways, is an updated version of that in terms of geodemographics for the internet age. And what this map, which I think comes from the MIT Media Labs, if I remember correctly, purports to show, are interactions in terms of social network traffic. Now, in his introductory comments, Anthony Finkelstein talked about issues of scale, of representation, and provenance. And I think it's actually quite important at this point to perhaps build on one of the issues that Mookie introduced in the previous presentation, and that is about the medium and the message, the way in which messages are conveyed to novice or even to professional users. And I think although maps like this look beguiling and present the illusion that the field is actually progressing and is producing useful measures of what's going on in terms of virtual identities and virtual media, there are very big questions to ask about the scale at which that representation is created compared to the Shefkin and Bell representation at the sub 100 meter scale. The way in which it's represented in terms of flows, but also crucially of the provenance, the extent to which not only the ISP locations of Facebook users can be accurately geo-referenced, but also the wider issue of how representative Facebook users are of non-Facebook users, something that will possibly be preoccupying the stock markets this morning. With due deference to Susie and Tao, I'm afraid you can smell the testosterone when you look at this unholy alliance of rogues who are sort of making up this uncertainty of identity project. Perhaps I'll put the lights back on so that you can't see it so well. That might help. Those are the sorts of issues which we're seeking to address. Actually move geodemographics into an era in which it can say something meaningful about social media, but also something that is robust and defensible in geographic terms, in terms with respect to generalization. Okay, enough by way of sort of preamble. This is really one of the linking mechanisms, one of the sort of data infrastructures that we're seeking to create in order to accomplish this. One of my colleagues in the geography department is Pablo Matios. Okay, he's Spanish. And if you take a data file like the electoral roll, you have given names paired with family names. And so taking the name Pablo, I might say, well, okay, someone called Pablo Matios is Spanish. And what I might use is that name to identify other family names which are associated with Pablo, and they're probably Spanish. And then I can go back to the given names and look at the given names of people who have these additional names, and then look at their family names, and so on and so forth. And before long, I develop a naming network of people who are Spanish, and I can see someone who's Portuguese or Greek, or Chinese, or Indonesian, or anything like that. And when I do this for a big enough database, and basically what we've been doing in geography is mining a database which currently represents over 30 countries worldwide and contains hundreds of millions of observations, I build up what is described here as a naming network. And again, if we switch the lights down, you can see in terms of the pairings of names that there aren't many links, for example, between Indian names and Danish names, but there are stronger names, links, I'm sorry, you do need 20/20 vision to see this, but there are stronger links, for example, between people with Danish names and Norwegian names. Sarish, who's working at City University, is developing some of these analyses, for example, of the genealogy, if you like, of Indian names. And Mirko at Birmingham is working with these kinds of complex networks, which help us to establish the strength, if you like, of weak ties in terms of family naming networks. How's that useful about telling us about geodemographics, about people and places? Well, the way it's useful is if we look at this slide from one of our legacy websites, in terms of the UK census of population, Polish people are white others. A bit like Arabs, a bit like Greeks, a bit like a lot of people who populate London. By using this names classification, we can identify the quite distinctive Zone 2 geography of people, people of Polish origin. And we can look similarly at the detailed geography of people in, of Japanese origins, in this case, in relation, for example, to the location of Japanese schools and so forth. So it tells us, so this kind of data infrastructure tells us a lot about people. It also tells us a lot about places. And here again, I think we'll have to take the lights out. This work is from James Cheshire in CASA, who will talk to us in a bit more detail about this in a minute. And what this map shows is actually the distribution of people with the name, to take the right-hand side one, which in 1881, that's this small your black circle, okay? And the outer circle here is the distribution of people called which, 95% of them, in the present day. And the abiding message of that map is that people called which don't get out much, okay? If you're engaged to marry a lady called Witch in London, and she may be quite keen to rid herself of that name, if you live in London, you can be fairly confident that the in-laws are not going to move out of Ramsbottom and come and settle on your back doorstep. Or at least they haven't. They haven't since family names came into common parlance in the 12th and 13th centuries. So what James's work has done is actually said, well, okay, we don't need to just look at the Witches and the Bakewells, but we can look at all of the names that characterise, I don't know, Ramsbottom, and build together a picture of what is distinctive about that area. And what James's work has done then is from this, it's built up a regional geography which specifies the effect of place. And this pushes the envelope in terms of geodemographics, because in geodemographic terms, everywhere is nowhere. It's fundamentally based upon social similarity. There's no explicit incorporation of locational proximity. Everywhere is nowhere, but what this work is doing is infusing this with a sense of place. Why is that important? Well, here's one example from another of our projects with the Oxford Genetics Group called the People of the British Isles, Walter Bodmer's group at the Wellcome Labs in Oxford. If the people called Witch haven't got out much between 1881 and the present day, they probably didn't get out much, you know, sort of the whole time from when they first settled the land as the first settlers or when they invaded the land, back to time immemorial. And what this map shows is actually, in actual fact, from the People of the British Isles project. This is work that's underway, which is why this map is only a detail and a provisional representation. But it's actually showing that we can actually trace people using their names back to their common ancestors. A name is a statement of your identity and indeed your genetic profile. People who live in Cornwall have different genetic profiles to people who live in Devon. As long as, and this really comes back to Anthony's comment about provenance or a different take about provenance, as long as the sample design which has been used to identify those people is fit for purpose. And it's not self-selecting, because the kinds of people who come forward and want to give you samples of their DNA tend to be loonies. They tend not to be representative of people who are not. Okay, how's this? Relevant to relating real and virtual worlds? Well, as I say, the uncertainty of identity project that we're doing with there's a collaboration between London City University and Birmingham University is only really just beginning to scratch the surface of ways in which we can link real and virtual worlds in ways that are anchored to distributions that actually mean something. And at the moment, I think our fundamental concern is that many of the empirical conclusions of social network analysis are a most naive form of empiricism, which are not representative of any discernible parent population. To date, this is really a legacy project, which is an industry strength a geodemographic classification that we developed in collaboration with Experian, which actually uses data on IT usage, consumption of magazines, media, and so forth, to devise a 20-type category of people's engagement with new information and communication technologies. that's a sort of an incremental update, a bespoke classification, if you like, of geodemographics. What Adnan will talk about in a few minutes really takes that one step forward in terms of collaboration that we're developing with CACI Limited in West Kensington, which uses email addresses as additional statements of identity. And you may say, oh no, that doesn't work. That doesn't work. I can change my email address. But you won't, will you? You'll say you will, but you won't. And these kinds of tags may be more transitory statements of identity and less indelible than the names that you were bequeathed. But they're nonetheless quite enduring statements of identity, which are better than nothing when we come to try to make sense of social media traffic. And that's me done. Thanks very much.